Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Argyle Community Church. As I'm sure most of you are aware, today is a very special and exciting day because it's not just a normal service. Today we have got a baptism of Beth and Nicola, and so we're so excited to celebrate with the two of them. And so if you're here to support them as friends and family, an extra special welcome to you. Anyone who doesn't know me, my name is Lizzie and I'm the youth and children's worker here at Argyle. So we've got a couple of notices before we start. First of all, as part of the celebration, we have got a bring and share lunch in the church after the service, so do hang around for that. And because of that, we won't have any evening prayer today. We also have got a exciting event coming up. We have got a pizza and board games night, which I did not write any notes about, which was an error of myself. But I think, oh, there we go. On the Saturday, the 18th of February, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m, there is a sign-up sheet in the other room, just so that we have an idea of numbers so we can know how much pizza to get. Tom and I will be supplying a lot of board games, but if you've got any that you want to bring, do bring them along, but don't worry if you want to come empty-handed. And finally, I've talked a few times recently about the fact that our toddler group books up within about 4 or 5 minutes each week, and we have made the decision that we're going to start looking into starting up another one. If this is something that you think you might be interested in helping out with, do come and chat to me. It will likely be on a Wednesday or Friday morning, details to be confirmed, but if you've got any interest, do come and chat to me about that. So let us start our worship with a song that was chosen by Nicola, Cornerstone.
Yes, all the songs today have been chosen by Nicola and Beth. This is a great one to start with, an expression of where our faith lies. So please, if you can, please stand and sing.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest faith. Righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Saviour's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, Savior's love. trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Saviour's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Saviour's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
Please sit down.
Welcome to all of you who have joined in that last song. I always notice a bit of a filling out of the congregation. Now, as we celebrate the baptism later on in the service, we get to witness this incredible sign and symbol that, amongst loads of other things, that these two ladies have been washed clean of their sin following repentance. And a baptism service is a great time for us to reflect on where we are with God. And to remind ourselves that if we too have declared Jesus as Lord and come to him with repentance, then we too have been washed completely clean. And so we're just going to have a moment where I'd like you to bring anything to your mind that you have done this week that has turned you away from God, that has been against his will, and then we're going to have a prayer of confession. So some words are going to come up on the screen, and I'll say the words in italic, and then I'd invite you to all join together in the words in bold. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. Lord, forgive us. Help us to walk in your ways. We have lived by the light of our own eyes, as faithless and not believing. Lord, forgive us. Help us to walk in your ways. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. Lord, forgive us. Help us to walk in your ways. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. Now let us continue in sung worship.
Second song's also chosen by Nicola. It's a great song. It starts off saying, Lord, I come to you, which is what we have to do. And it ends up by saying, we live every day in the power of his love. Please stand if you can.
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me be stripped away by the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes. Let me see you face to face. The knowledge of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life. In living every day by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround. Please sit down.
The following reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 7. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us grace has been given as Christ apportioned it.
Thank you, Gregory. And I think that reading was chosen by Nicola, wasn't it? My name's Jamie. I'm pastor of this church. Welcome. It's really great to see all of you here. Let me echo Lizzie's welcome, especially if you're family and friends of Nicola or Beth. It's great to see you here. We've come to the baptism part of the service now. I'm going to baptize Nicola and then Beth. But before I do that, I've asked both of them if they would share their story. How did they get here? How did they become a Christian and so on? So I'm going to hand over to Nicola first of all.
Morning, everybody. I'm used to standing up here, but today I feel really nervous. I've got everything down on my phone because I was told I've only got 5 minutes, so it stops me waffling. So when I was born 21 years ago, plus 26, I was born into a different faith. And although my parents didn't go to church, I was brought up in a faith school. And so that was my first dealings with God. But if I'm honest, I found it terrifying. And for me, I loved the parables, the stories Jesus told, but it didn't align with what I experienced. I found it cold. These people were supposed to be servants of God, yet they would hit me with a ruler at school if I'd been naughty. And it felt really black and white. You're either good or you sin, and if you sin, you're going to hell. So as a child, when I used to nip my brother when my parents weren't looking, or I spent my money, my dinner money on sweets rather than lunch, I thought, that's it, I've sinned, I'm going to hell. And also I felt I didn't have that relationship with God because everything was through somebody else. So you didn't pray to God directly when you confessed your sins. It was to somebody else who then chose to forgive you on behalf of God. So I didn't feel I had a relationship. So when I was 16, left school, that was it. That was my time done with church. Went through life, making bad choices, but thought I was getting on all right. And I have suffered a lot of pain and suffering in my life from my early childhood. And I got through it just thinking I was strong, just a strong person. But there always seemed as if there was something missing in my life. And then in January 2007, my nana died. And the vicar that was doing her funeral seemed really nice. It wasn't something I was used to, a man of the cloth being. And so the week after the funeral, the first Sunday, me and my family decided to go to that church where he, which he ran. And again, blew my mind. Walked in, it was light and airy. Everybody was welcoming, warm and friendly. So alien to me. And I thought, this might be something I could get used to. So I carried on going to church and I started coming back to faith. And they ran a starter course. It wasn't the Alpha course, it was a starter course. And I attended that. And, you know, I've got Chris, the vicar, a lot to thank for on the start of my journey. So during the starter course, I saw that the transforming power of a life following Christ was available to me. And driving home from the last session, I suddenly became overwhelmed and began to repent out aloud of all my sins and the wrong choices I had made in my life and asking for God's forgiveness for me turning away from him, causing him hurt for ignoring him. I then cried uncontrollably, not because I was sad, but because of pure joy. I realized that he had always been there by my side, even in my darkest moments, even though I didn't see him. The strength I felt and how I got through everything was him. That he never abandoned me like I had him, and he welcomed me again with open arms and joy when I sought him out. And it always took me back to the prodigal son because that's how it felt. And in that moment, for the first time ever in my life, I was 31 at the time, I felt loved and cherished as someone who was not worthless but precious, and that I would never ever feel so alone again. I had someone looking out for me and who would finally have someone by my side holding my hand. The realization that I had always had that from him, but just didn't know it at the time. It was at this moment I accepted Jesus as my savior and was filled with the Holy Spirit, and a complete sense of peace washed over me. I made a connection to Jesus that brought comfort, wisdom, understanding, peace, confidence, and freedom. My life was forever changed. It gave me a new identity and a new hope, a better quality of life. Allowing faith to impact my life touched my spirit, my emotions, my relationships, my purpose, and my ability to identify and use the spiritual gifts I'd been given. I wanted to be baptized again as an adult, as my choice of accepting God into my life. I wanted to make that public declaration, but the church I was going to wouldn't baptize me because they'd seen I'd already been baptized. And actually, I was quite thankful because I wasn't sure how the vicar would lift me up over the font and put water over my head. But what they did say I could do was be blessed in the church and received into the church, which again scared me because in my previous faith, you were received into church the eve before your funeral. But I still did it. Then I moved to Reading 13 years ago, coming up in June. Went to a few churches, didn't feel right. But then a phone call with Mark on a completely different topic is what brought me to Argyle. And when I found out Jamie was the pastor, I've known Jamie and Claire previously, I thought this all makes sense. And so this is how I ended up at Argyle. Since becoming a Christian, my career choices changed and I started working with vulnerable people, giving a voice to the unheard. In my current role, working with victims of modern slavery, I believe that is my calling and purpose. I experience evil firsthand every day. And people often ask me, who are non-Christians, how do you believe in God with what you see and hear? But it's not God doing the evil, it's other people. And I just thank him every day for the gifts and abilities he's given me in order to do this work, the compassion, kindness, and the strength and courage to be the light in their dark and their hope and to give them their freedom. Being a Christian doesn't mean you have an easier life. I still have trials and struggles, but it is easier to cope with now as my burdens are shared, decisions are not made on my own, and I'm far from perfect and still sometimes question him. I'm sure my children will say patience isn't something I really have a lot of and I'm working on it, but I'm learning to trust in his plans for me more and his timings as well. And time again, it always does work out how it should be. So right here, right now, is where I'm meant to be. So I stand here before you today to finally have the opportunity publicly declare that Jesus is my saviour, that my life following him is transformative, exciting, and resilient. And that deep within my heart, I know that although I'm not perfect, I am someone who is loved unconditionally, I'm worthy, and who will never be alone again. Children who can't string proper sentences together and have abbreviations, so like LOL, laugh out loud, FOMO, fear of missing out. There's a new one called GOAT, which is greatest of all time. He is my greatest of all time. He is the truth, the life and way, my protection, my guide, my comfort and strength, my light in darkness, joy in time of sorrow, my rock and cornerstone, my hope. He is a blessed and wonderful saviour. His love, mercy and grace are a balm to broken people. He has healed me and has launched me into a beautiful life of service, and I'm excited to carry on my journey of faith with the most wonderful church community.
Hi everyone, my name is Beth and I am happy that this day has come. All my life I have believed in God and followed Jesus in the Catholic Church. I have to say that this is the second time that I have been baptized, but my first time was when I was a baby. I was only a few months old and I did not aware the meaning of top buttons. My history here begins after the lockdown in July 2021. Walking along one day, I passed here and I saw a big torch sign offering help in very difficult time for everyone. At the time, I was feeling lonely and I have no confidence and I needed help with my English. And after hesitating for several days, I sent an email. The next day, I received an invitation from Francis to meet me for coffee. She told me about Bridges, the English class here where she was a teacher. Days later, she was also the one who invited me to come to the Serbia here. And I discovered something that I have been looking for a long time. A community where the people seem it to have a personal relationship with God. I found a great family and everything that entails love, respect, support, friendship. One Sunday, someone gave me everyone a Jesus piece, which represented me as a small part that was part of the great puzzle that is this church, led by a great pastor, Jamie. This is special for me because it represents for me that I am part of this family in Argyle. About a year ago, I met with Francis to read and understand more of the Bible. We studied the essential course, and it was so helpful for me. I also learned about adult baptism for the first time and what it means. Throughout the years, like everyone else, I have experienced many things. In recent months, things have been very difficult for me, but God has always been with me, and I trust Him completely. I felt totally lost and vulnerable, but there was something that it is reminds in my life, God. Today I can say that my life is very different. I look forward to a life full of new experience to life that bring peace, joy, and calm to my life. But things for me is accepting the opportunity that God offered me to start over, to be born again in this life. It is also a symbol of this new life that I am beginning now and of that new future that I am already beginning to write in the history of my life. But things is for me also like a cleaning and dressing in clean clothes to start again with more desire, with more confidence, and with more love. I am leaving the past behind and starting over with everything I have learned. In my new backpack for this new trip, there is in my trust and my faith in God in every circumstance of my life. Knowing that, although sometimes I am not able to understand it, I don't need proof that He always knows what is the best for me. I don't need to worry about the future because I know God loves me very much. He cares for me and protects me. One of my favorite verses is Philippians 4, 6, verse 6, 7. It says, "Do not worry about anything. Instead, pray to God about everything. Ask Him to help with the things that you need and thank Him for His help. If you do that, God will give your peace in your mind That pain is so great that no one can completely understand it. You will not worry or be afraid because you belong to in Christ Jesus. So I only have one word to summarize everything I feel and to start this new journey, and it is thank you with capital letters. On this special day for me, I would like to thank Torch and his team for that poster that caused me a great change in my life. And I would like to thank especially a few people who are very dear to me. A special thank you very much to Mark, Cheryl, Frances, Jamie, and Marina. Thanks for your love, understanding, and continued support for me. And of course, myself, Ivan. I love all of you a lot. You, all you know it. And thank you, my Lord, because you always listen to me. Thank you, my Lord, for giving me the opportunity to start over with what I know and I am now. Thank you, my Lord, for teaching me what is really important in the life. Thank you, my Lord, for guiding me by your hand on the path that leads me to you. Thank you, my God, for the wonderful travel companion that can accompany me on the journey of the life. My Lord, I am in your hands. Your purpose is my purpose. Guide me to you all the day of my life. This is my favorite song that says, I will follow you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. When you move, I will move. I will follow you. I love you, my God. Thanks all of you for sharing me this special day with me. And God bless all you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Beth and Nicola. It was really lovely to hear how God has dealt with you in your life and brought you to himself. As a church, we have a gift for you both that I just want to mention now. We've bought you each a book called Hope When It Hurts, Biblical Reflections to help you grasp God's purpose in your suffering. And inside the book is your certificate of baptism. And we have a verse that we've chosen for you on this occasion. Nicola, your verse is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. That's yours, Nicola. And your verse, Beth, is from 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. You can pick up these books from the table later. Well, we're going to do the baptisms now. I'd like to invite the children, when I get down into the water, the children are welcome to come forward and crouch down so they get a better view. But I will just say, with the parents' consent, because we don't want any extra baptisms today, okay? So if you trust that your children can just come and crouch down so they've got a better view, do come forward, boys and girls, but the baptisms should be on the screen so that those of you who are at the back can also see. Okay.
Right. Boys and girls, come forward if you want to. That's fine. Now, you just wait a second. You come in, Mark.
Guys, can you move back? Move back. Move back.
Boys and girls,
move back.
Bounce down. Right.
Too near, too near. Down. Yeah. Well done. That's it. That's it.
Okay, Nicola, I'm going to ask you some questions. Have you repented of your sin?
Yes.
Have you trusted in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Will you seek to live for Jesus and the glory of God?
I will.
Come and be baptized. Nicola, upon your profession of repentant faith in the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Will you seek to live for Jesus and the glory of God? Come and be baptized. Faith in the Lord Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
The following reading was chosen by Beth, and it's from Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 to 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Let us do as that Bible verse said, present to God thanksgiving and petition. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love, that we have become sons and daughters of a heavenly Father. We pray for Nicola and Beth and ask for your goodness and blessings to be poured out into both of their lives. We thank you that they have been faithful servants today and pray that they will continue to be so. Father, we thank you that we don't need to face our struggles alone, for you alone are always with us, and you hear our prayers. We lift up to you those who are in our church family and surrounding community that are hurting. We lift up Joy and the Davis family following Brian's funeral, for Lana and Vita and their families both in the UK and still in Ukraine. We pray for anyone who's worried about money as the cost of living increases. We pray that you will take away all of these people's fears, their anxieties, and that you will surround them with your love and your comfort. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, it's meant to be the sermon now, but as Jamie's not quite made it through that door yet, I just want to share how exciting that was to see. And it is such a celebration that we can all be here with them. I thought it was really significant that both of their stories involved this community. And I just wanted to share what a privilege it has been for me coming to this church and really being welcomed into this community. It is so amazing, the variety we have here, the diversity and the welcome that I have felt. So thank you, all of you, for being a part of that. And I'll hand over to Jamie now.
Good. If you've not seen a full immersion baptism before, you may be thinking, wow, what's this all about? Why does this church have hidden beneath the stage something that looks like a mini swimming pool and they dunk people in it? What's that about? If baptism seems a bit strange or confusing to you, don't worry. We're going to look at it in some detail now, just for the next 10 minutes, and we'll explore what baptism is. So first of all, why do we baptize? Well, we do it because Jesus commanded us to baptize. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 and 19 say, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples. That word disciple means a follower of Jesus. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So with the authority that was given to him by God the Father, because he is God the Son, Jesus commands his disciples to make disciples and baptize them. In other words, to go out to all nations, tell them the good news about Jesus,
and then baptize the people who believe. It's God's will that everyone who becomes a Christian should be baptized. If we become a Christian, we should obey him. Obeying God is part of the Christian life. Nicola and Beth have obeyed Jesus. They've become a Christian and they've been baptized. I wonder, if you're a Christian, have you obeyed Jesus? Have you been baptized? If not, you should be. It's God's command to us if we've put our faith in Jesus. So that's why we baptize. Let's think now, when do we baptize? It's important to realize that baptism happens after you've repented and put your faith in Jesus. So to repent means to turn away from your sin and your life of living without God. To put your faith in Jesus means to trust him, to believe in him, that he was punished in your place on the cross so that you can be saved from punishment for your sins after you die. When you've done that, when you've repented and trusted in Jesus, then you're baptized. And we see this pattern in the Bible. For example, Acts chapter 8, verse 12. But when they believed Philip, as he proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus, they were baptized, both men and women. So we see it there. They listened to Philip. He shared the good news about Jesus. They believed that good news. They had repentant faith in Jesus. And so, because of that, they were baptized. That's the pattern. Believing the good news, repenting and trusting in Jesus, then baptism. That, you see, it's the believing and repenting that makes you a Christian. And we are baptized to show that we have become a Christian. This process did not make Nicola or Beth into a Christian. They've already become Christians and have been baptized to show us all that they have. Another question, where do we baptize? Well, we baptize in public because baptism is a public declaration of repentant faith in Jesus. It's an outward sign of an inward faith, an inward reality. When you put your faith in Jesus, that's a private, personal, invisible thing which is between us and God. We do it in our hearts in response to realizing how much Jesus loves us, that he's died for us. People can't necessarily see us doing this, but God wants people to know what has happened to us. He wants us to publicly declare to all our family and friends, to everyone around us, that we've repented, we've put our faith in Christ. Sometimes you go to a wedding and you see someone dressed in a kilt, don't you? And by wearing a kilt, someone is declaring, I am Scottish. Francis is nodding. Yeah, I was going to use that. That's what you wear a kilt, I'm Scottish. But baptism is similar. By being baptized, you're declaring you belong to Jesus. You're part of his kingdom. Or when a man proposes to his girlfriend and she says yes, and he gives her an engagement ring, what does she do? She shows everyone. She tells everyone. She puts it on Instagram because she's so happy that she's going to be united to her fiancé in marriage. And baptism is like that ring. It's declaring, I am united to Jesus now. By faith, I've been joined to him, and I want everyone to know. I'm declaring it. It's automatically on YouTube, so you don't even have to put it up there. The whole world can know that you are baptized and you are a follower of Jesus. But what does baptism symbolize? Because it symbolizes two very important things. First of all, baptism symbolizes spiritual death and life. So Colossians chapter 2, verse 12 says, having been buried with him, that's Jesus, in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. So what baptism does is it symbolically reenacts Jesus' death and resurrection. When you're baptized, you go into the water, and that symbolizes death. Just as Jesus died for our sin on the cross, we have died to sin in our lives. We're dead to the old way of living. We no longer live the life of sin, the life of ignoring God, the life of not having him in our lives. And then you go under the water in baptism, and that symbolizes burial. Our baptism is like a funeral for our old selves. We're putting it to death. The burial bit, the going under the water bit, shows this. And then you come up out of the water, and that symbolizes resurrection. Just as Jesus was raised from the dead by God's glorious power, we are made spiritually alive by God's glorious power. Now we live a new and a distinctive life, the life of a Christian. And that's what the coming up out of the water bit symbolizes. By being baptized, Beth and Nicola are telling us that they no longer live as they used to. They've died to living with sin and self at the center of their lives. They're alive to God now, living with him at the center of their lives. But baptism symbolizes something else as well. Cleansing. In the Bible, water often symbolizes cleansing from sin. So baptism symbolizes that our sins have been washed away. You see, when we trust in Jesus, our sins are forgiven. And when God forgives us, that means he doesn't count our sins against us anymore. If our sins are like a big debt that we owe, he cancels the debt. And we thought about that last week. As we go through life, as Nicola referred to in her story, we sin, every one of us. Sin is rebelling against God. It's going our own way. It's ignoring God. It's breaking his commands. It's living without him. Every time we sin, it's like we build up dirt in our lives, the dirt of sin on our souls, as it were. But when we trust in Jesus, he takes our dirt, our sin, on himself. He's punished for it, and then he gives us his total purity so that we're washed and clean in God's sight. You may have noticed, you may have been thinking that this baptismal pool is a bit like a big bath. We go right under when we're baptized, signifying that we've been totally and entirely forgiven of all our sin, all our guilt and shame and uncleanness and impurity has been washed away by Jesus. That's what baptism reminds us of. That's what it signifies. That's what it symbolizes. The actual water doesn't do anything. Beth and Nicola's sins weren't washed away when they were baptized just now. Trusting in Jesus is how your sins are washed away. Baptism symbolizes that that's happened to you. So Beth and Nicola, you've been cleansed of your sin by Jesus. You're now accepted and honored and forgiven and free from shame and loved by God. God is looking at you both now. What kind of look is on his face? Is he frowning at you? Is he rolling his eyes? Is he yawning? No. His face lights up because you're his daughters, because you're cleansed and pure, because Jesus has dealt with your sin and he counts you as his family. That's what baptism signifies and symbolizes. Wonderful, isn't it, to think of these things? Well, that's baptism, but I want to finish off by asking this question. How about you? I wonder, will you follow the path that Beth and Nicola have taken? Will you repent of your sin, put your faith in Jesus, and be baptized? I hope you will. I urge you to, because it's the best thing you could ever do, because it gives you new and eternal life. It means your sins are dealt with. It means you're accepted by God and enfolded in his love. Well, thank you so much for listening and for being here today. Just to say that if you want to take some booklets away with you about baptism, there are some on the table down here. They're free. Please help yourself. And if you've got any questions about becoming a Christian or being baptized, perhaps you want to, just do chat with me afterwards and I'll be happy to discuss that with you. God bless you. Thank you.
We're going to sing our final song now. It's a great song. I think it's one of my favourites, actually. King of Kings, Majesty. And it's got a chorus that, if you're a Christian, you should be singing this from your heart. Your Majesty, I can but bow, I lay my all before you now. In royal robes, I don't deserve. I live to serve. Your Majesty, please stand.
King of Kings, Majesty. Saviour, closest friend, strong deliverer, beginning and end. All within me falls at your throne, your Majesty. I can but bow, I lay my you. Love eternal, faithful and true, who bought the nations, ransomed souls, brought this sinner near to your throne. All within me cries out in praise, your
For joining us. As you do go through, please do be careful because there is some water on the floor, so it might be a little bit slippery. And again, just a reminder, we have our bring and share lunch after the service, so do join us for that. A few passages actually from Revelation were coming to my mind during the service. So let's just finish by me reading those and then praying. Great and awe-inspiring are your works, Lord God the Almighty. Righteous and true are your ways, King of the nations. Lord, who will not fear and glorify your name because you alone are holy? All the nations will come and worship before you because your righteous acts have been revealed. Alleluia, because our Lord God the Almighty has begun to reign. Let us be glad, rejoice, and give him glory because the marriage of the Lamb has come and his wife has prepared herself. Look, God's dwelling is with men and he will live with them. They will be his people and God himself will be with them and be their God. So Heavenly Father, we pray for Nicola and Beth this morning. May they walk forward, cleansed of their sin, loved by their Father. May they follow the leading of our Lord Jesus Christ, guiding their paths. And may they be filled with the Holy Spirit, flowing with love and grace. And Lord, we ask for all of these things for everyone in this room too. Guide our footsteps this week as we live lives that are glorifying and honouring you, Lord. Amen. Thank you very much.